Thank you for that wonderful introduction. First of all, congratulations to Team Joshua for this wonderful summit. I know how difficult it is to organize a webinar because I've been doing it on and off, both officially and also for social initiatives. But organizing a webinar with a different, international speakers and for 5 days is actually a big task. I think Joshua, congratulations! You have done your team has done a really great job. Again, thank you for calling me for this inauguration session of the fourth day. I think it's the fourth day, yeah, the fourth day of your summit. I've been following up for the last 3 days with your summit. It's been very very informative. Sessions, all your speakers were top class, and just sitting across the iPad or sitting just with a phone, I think most of us have had wonderful information from all across the world, from different experts from different walks of life. So when when Joshua called me and asked me to inaugurate today's session, I had a request for him. I told him I'm ready to inaugurate the session. I know I can see who the speakers are. And also, I know there will be a varied guests who are taking part in this webinar. So, I've been, for the last couple of months, I've been talking about a particular issue, you can call it an issue, in all possible platforms which I have got to speak. So I didn't want to miss this platform too, because I know there will be people from different walks of life, different age groups attending this webinar. So I would like to touch upon that particular topic, and then I would like to give the floor to the other honorable speakers. As Joshua introduced, we run a maritime university. A very small maritime institution, which has turned out to be a very maritime university. We are almost 30 years old. So as I told you, that issue which I've been talking about for last couple of months is about one neglected group of the frontline warriors. Because all of us know the frontline warriors are the doctors, the nurses, the cops, the police on the streets, a lot of people whom we can see, who are really, really working hard during this pandemic times. But there are one group of people who are also working hard during this pandemic times for us, for all the people across the world. But unfortunately, just because they are not in front of our eyes, they are not visible for us. So they have been easily neglected or not come in front of the scene. I am talking about the people working on the ships, the mariners, the merchant seafarers who keep the world warm and fed are trapped in floating prisons. Shipping companies do appreciate the hardships and resilience of seafarers amid this global pandemic, yet thousands are still stranded at sea. Seafarers are the backbone of the global community, who are tirelessly operating 24/7 to move our needs in this COVID pandemic and beyond. Our governments and the global community is doing enough to recognize their sacrifices? I don't think so. Despite the pivotal role they play in the good times, and especially the bad, the seafarers remain marginalized and largely invisible. This needs to change. With the world in the midst of corona pandemic, the shipping industry is already feeling the impact as the global economy heads into a deep recession. Hundreds of ships sailing have been canceled as first ports in China and then across the globe have seen trade fall away, with millions of workers and consumers in lockdown. Caught in the center of this have been the world's 1.6 million seafarers. I repeat, 1.6 million seafarers on 50,000 tankers and cargo carriers. Many of them are unable to leave their ships or find themselves stuck in hotels without pay and unable to get flights home. Every month, normally during the regular times, every month 1 lakh merchant mariners come to the end of their contract on their ships and need to be flown home. But the pandemic has halted all this. Some of these seafarers have spent 9 months away from their families already. 9 months, can you believe? And it's not looking particularly likely they'll be able to go home anytime soon. The world's biggest shipping firm, you all must have heard, the A.P. Moller Maersk, is the one of those which has halted its crew changes and says it's done so to protect them by lessening the number of social interaction they need to have. So this is the kind of struggle this particular group of people, the so-called mariners, the seafarers who are out in the middle of the ocean, somewhere in the middle of the ocean, nowhere, they call it nowhere. And you know, they are trying to get us oil. They are trying to get us supplies without which, you know, we cannot survive. So what will be the effect of COVID-19 on the shipping industry beyond 2020? With virtually no cargo moving by air. I mean, first of all, we are not able to fly. So there is no chance of cargo moving by air. So shipping could become even more crucial. As it is, 90% of world trade by volume goes only by sea. Yet many analysts expect the drop in demand across Europe and North America to have a longer term impact. We could be taking a decade at least of difficulty. Alan Murphy says the pandemic will trigger questions about the shape and sustainability of world trade and globalization. A lot of protectionist arguments are going to be made against outsourcing. So it will have a very profound impact on how global supply chains are organized. This is going to be a political topic in the coming years. So it is my duty to talk about people who I work with, people whom I'm involved with, the mariners, seafarers. And thank you, Joshua, for giving me this platform. So from now on, all the listeners, please add seafarers, mariners into your frontline warrior list. Thank you, Joshua. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, brother. Can we have a couple of quick questions, brother, from the participants?
Yes, yes, absolutely. Yes, definitely.
On behalf of the participants, first question is, could you mention what are the job opportunities available in the maritime field post-COVID-19?
See, as I told you, Joshua, 90%, I mean, before COVID pandemic, 90% of world trade moves through ships, only through ships. So, which means... If we say for a day, the shipping industry goes on a strike. Just imagine for a day, then some country in the world will not have salt. Some country in the world will not have sugar. Some one part of the world will not have rice. So shipping industry is always a thriving industry. Come what may, you know, the fuel prices may go up, the fuel prices might come down. No recession, nothing can hit the shipping industry. In this shipping industry, as you asked, there are different kinds of opportunities, right? From, as I told you, the guys who work on ship, the guys who build ships, the guys who do trading, they do logistics. So there are a lot of varied options, varied opportunities. Maybe you can, towards the end of the session, maybe you can highlight our university's website where people can go and get more details about different career options in maritime industry.
Thank you very much, brother. The next question is, what could be the various possible courses that one could take up to enter this particular industry? And is there any prerequisite to join those programs?
Okay, so now we are in the towards the end of academic year. But unfortunately, our young boys and girls who have just completed their 12th, I mean, who are supposed to complete their 12th, they've had a lot of struggle, you know. They didn't have, some of them couldn't give their exams. Their exams got postponed. And now I think the government has come up with some kind of understanding where, from the previous marks, they'll end up getting their plus two results. So I will first tell you about plus two students. Plus two students have an option of, as I told you, they can go to sea as a marine engineer or a captain. For that, they should have plus two plus max physics chemistry. And 60% in physics, chemistry, max aggregate. Also, we do have ship building courses, which we call it as naval architects, for which again the students should have, plus two students should have a PCM, physics, chemistry, max with 50%. For the postgraduates, we exclusively run MBA courses for shipping and logistics, for shipping finance. for which the basic requirement is any degree with the first class, which is 60%. So these are the available options. I mean, I've kept it very brief, but in detail they can get it on our website, which is www.ametuniv.ac.in. I repeat, it is www.ametuniv.ac.in.
Thank you, brother. Brother, one last question, brother.
Yes.
If anybody wants to start a business, do you think this is the right time and your thoughts about it?
Anybody wants to start a business? As it is, I don't, as a businessman, I don't think this is the right time. Our Alibaba king Jack Ma says, surviving 2020 itself is a profit. So as a businessman, I don't suggest opening up new business, but this pandemic has brought a lot of demand for a lot of things, which I think our youngsters, they know better, because for example, the medicos, the medical related equipments, and the medical demand is very, very high. So something related to that can work. And supply chain, logistics, supply chain is a very big business. It's booming. You know, we are still sitting at home and we are still getting our food. We are still getting our Amazon orders. We are still getting our furniture ordered, delivered. So logistics and supply chain is definitely a good business to think about. And internet related businesses, like, you know, like what we right now, the Zoom call. So internet and internet related businesses are also a good option. But I think, again, it depends on, see, in India, unfortunately, every single business is done by, for example, you can take a vegetable seller. There is someone selling vegetables at our doorstep. And there is this biggest company called Reliance, who is also selling vegetables in a shop called Reliance Fresh. So how do you expect this guy who is selling vegetables at my door to compete with the Reliance Fresh? So that is the biggest challenge India is facing. All big time business giants are into all businesses, unlike other countries. And if you take European countries, for example, if there is someone, if there's a big giant in one industry, he will continue to do only that business. But as unlike in India, as I told you, there is someone selling vegetable at my doorstep. And even the world's ninth richest man who was declared debt-free. He's got zero loans, debt-free. I think last couple of weeks back, ninth richest man in the world, they say, is also selling vegetables. So that is the imbalance in our market, I guess. But youngsters, this is the time to think what works as a business. At the same time, not to, you know, be over ambitious and burn your fingers also.
Thank you very much, brother, for answering all the questions very patiently and for inaugurating today's session. On behalf of all the participants and myself, I would like to